My name is Greg Wilford. I'm the Chief Mobility and Marketing Officer at AP Technology. And, you know, a lot has changed since I co-founded a company back in 2001 that had integrated billing with carriers in 187 countries. You know, back then, I thought that was the Holy Grail. I thought that that was going to be how billing was done in the future, that you would have anytime, anywhere access to anything you wanted, you'd be able to pay for it right from your phone. And I figured that the carriers, since they already had billing systems in place, that they would be the banks. And while I was wrong about that, the mobile payment thing on mobile phones has really started to get traction. In fact, this year, eMarketer says that mobile payments are expected to triple in the United States. So we're getting some traction, but in many ways, mobile payments mirrors the early days of the Wild West. And so we thought we'd have a little fun with this. We're going to have a Wild West theme, and you'll hear lots of bad analogies related to the Wild West today. But the point is that in many ways, it does mirror early development, from pioneers striking out to discover gold, to the outlaws that are out to, you know, turn bustling businesses into ghost towns, right? So what would we do? We formed our own posse. We're going to call ourselves the Pay Gang, and we've got some folks on stage from various disciplines within the mobile payment ecosystem, and we're going to be talking about everything from security. Of course, we're going to be talking about data, and how we can turn that into gold. Thus the tagline, there's gold in them thar bills. Because if you use data properly, and we all adopt best practices, there are some wonderful ways that everybody in this room can grow your businesses. So we're gonna try to keep you out of harm's way, keep you away from the outlaws, and lead you towards, you know, striking your own claim in the mobile space. So, as I mentioned, mobile payments has really evolved over the last several years, especially with regards to security. You know, there are so many things going on. We've gone through tokenization. We've gone through, you know, basically passwords. And, you know, when you talk about payments and security, you almost have to mention our first guest, which his name is Richard Love. He's been in the payment space for nearly 30 years. And not only is he a technologist, but he has a number of patents related to payments under his name. And so, Richard, first of all, welcome to the MPC stage.
Thank you, Greg.
You know, I mentioned that payments has changed a lot over the years. What have you seen in terms of changes?
Well, it's an interesting question because in some ways, at one level, it's like, you know, payments, especially in the United States, have been very slow. And you haven't seen much payments, many changes. In 1991, 92, I was out there telling everybody that checks were dead. I mean, electronic payments were going to take over checks, and we wouldn't see checks anymore. They still exist in the billions. So I was completely wrong there. And some of the other technology has taken longer than we think. But, you know, what's really happened is underneath, especially in the last 5 to 10 years, underneath the technology has been a lot of really cool innovations taking place because, you know, things like at some point the internet came aboard, then mobile devices became prevalent. And so because of that, technology underneath it became much better, much more enhanced to make those payments work, to keep ahead of the fraudsters. You know, analytics and encryption technology and all sorts of, you know, biometrics and things like that, tokenization you're talking about, have really, really changed a lot. And in the last couple of years, we're actually people are seeing and feeling the changes in payments with bitcoins and mobile payments and some other things that are just in the news. And so people are a lot more aware of it. But I definitely agree, it does parallel the Old West. And what one lesson we ought to learn from that is that the criminals work a little faster than we do. And so even if we think we're there, we've got it, we've got to keep evolving to stay ahead of it. So,
great. Well, you've been at it for a long time, and there's no jokes about the silver stuff on your hair. But When you're talking about mobile payments, it's really easy to talk about all the things that can go wrong, right? Especially with the fraud being what it is today. You'll see a stat on the screen a little bit later where there's a fraud index that comes up, fraud attack index, where in 2015, there was a 235% increase in fraud attacks from the previous year. Well, that same index came out at the end of last week, and for the four quarters ending in March 2016, fraud attacks are up another 137%. So Richard is absolutely right. The bad guys are busy, you know, but there's a lot going right in this space. And when you talk about somebody who absolutely gets payments and is doing it right, you have to talk about our next guest. So Jim Shortan is ahead of all sales globally for PayPal. You've heard of PayPal? They're at a few places. Yeah, so we'll be going to Jim frequently and talking to him about what is working and maybe ways that you all can apply learnings to your own businesses. But, you know, Jim, let's state the obvious. First of all, is this really a big deal? Is a mobile initiative that big a deal for businesses?
Yeah, Greg, absolutely. I think if, you know, as you said it, mobile is going to grow threefold in the next few years. If you look at just the trend lines, ComScore came out with a recent study in the last 6 months that said that mobile commerce has grown by a 40% clip, far outpacing retail and just e-commerce. So from a digital standpoint, if merchants, and hopefully there's some merchants in the room because that's who I best relate to, really want to win in the digital space, you've got to really capitalize on taking advantage of some of the tools that companies, whether it's PayPal or some of the networks, there's a lot of options out there, a lot of different ways to help mine that gold that's out there in the hills. You know, what I would say is, you know, as merchants have really two options. They can revert to 1840s and, you know, have a pickaxe and a pan and see if they can, you know, mine some flakes out of the hills. Or they can invest in true partnerships and, you know, get some trommels and some, you know, some really high tech metal detectors and really find some powerful gold to get. So the point is give your customers better tools so that when they're shopping and buying on a mobile device,
It's a good experience.
It's easy to convert. Because right now, every time I go in to talk to a merchant and I ask, what's your pain point? Mobile conversion.
Yep. Mm. And after all, nobody wants to be Buffalo Billed. Lots more to come.
It doesn't stop
Lots
there.
More to come. Thanks, Jim. Okay. You know, a lot of times we get too immersed in this space from our own perspectives, but when we want to dig into mobile payments at its essence, you know, find out exactly what's happening on a lot of different levels and also judge that against metrics, both, you know, past and forecasts, there's one source to go to. It's analysts, right? So if you're reading Wall Street Journal and they're talking about mobile payments, the author of that article is not necessarily a mobile expert. But analysts dig deep into that. They immerse themselves in that and focus on one vertical. So we are really fortunate here to have someone here who has delved into the mobile space for a long time. You'll find some of his learnings on Forbes, some of the reports that he's done. He's got a number of them. Please welcome Evan Baker from BI Intelligence. Hi, Evan.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going great. The first thing is you kind of are the reality check. You know, we can talk about how great mobile is. We're going to be tripling this year in terms of transactions on mobile devices. Is all of this right? Are we really gaining traction, or are we missing something? Are mobile payments going to be a dud?
Yeah, it's an essential question, and you know, as a millennial who's probably written 5 checks in his life, I think there's also another perspective here at the conference. So, you know, the story so far, I think, with mobile payments, at least in the U.S., you know, we've seen awareness really skyrocket in the last year and a half since a lot of wallets have come out. You'll see a lot of surveys where it's like the vast majority of mobile users have heard of things like Apple Pay, Android Pay, Samsung Pay. But you also see other surveys that show, you know, interest usage is kind of lagging behind that awareness. But that being said, I think it's a question of when and not if mobile payments hit that sort of critical mass. And it's going to come through a number of things. It's going to be a concerted effort. It's not just going to be one thing. You know, you're going to see things like as loyalty proliferates, you're going to see usage go up. You know, also as the infrastructure is built out, which, you know, I think is a problem that will resolve itself over time. You know, I think even if you looked at connected devices, which are finally being released, keep in mind these aren't just smartphone payments that we're talking about. This is mobile payments, right? This is mobile devices of all types. And so I think through sort of a bundle of those sort of drivers, we're going to see mobile payments take off, definitely in the U.S. within the next few years. And, you know, like Jim was saying earlier, you know, you have mobile commerce too, which is definitely going to outpace PC commerce eventually. So they're here
to stay. Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay, rounding out the pay gang, if you are a fan of country music, then you know the person I'm going to introduce right now. He's a frequent resident on Billboard's country music charts. His hits include Midnight Rider, Fire's Out, and a number of others. And for your viewing and listening pleasure, I put together a little.
Nice.
And it's almost his birthday.
Oh, great. Sounds great.
Anybody could plug, you know, plug in.
That's not embarrassing.
Gonna love you just the same, just the same. I'm always gonna feel this way. No, it's never gonna change until the last breath I take. I'm gonna love you just the same, just the same. I'm gonna love you just the same.
Very nice.
Oh,
oh yeah.
That's the only reason I'm here.
You know, by way of introduction, Rick is not only an artist who performs here in the United States, he is actually one of the U.S.'s foremost ambassadors in country music. Having traveled all over the world, some of the places he's traveled include Sarajevo, he's been to Cuba. A while ago, he was the first American to sing the national anthem in Vietnam in over 25 years after the cessation of hostilities between the between North and South. And Rick, you travel around so much, you get to use your mobile phone almost everywhere you go. First of all, where are you going next? I can't keep up with you.
Next this week, I think we have Georgia, Oklahoma, and Wisconsin. We're doing, we take off Thursday to start that, and we're basically playing every weekend. Out of Nashville, we end up playing like 3 or 4 days a week. So.
Okay. Well, you know, we've got some mobile experts from different disciplines up on here on stage. You kind of present the man on the street, how you can really apply mobile payments to your business. Is mobile payments a big deal? Do these guys need to create a mobile initiative if they don't already have one? And why is it so important to merchants?
Well, for us, what we do as a business is it's an impulse buy. You know, we're non-essential luxury, right? Yeah. And it's basically, because music is, you hear it, you want to get it. And the thing is, you want to make, and we've been talking about this a lot, is the frictionless transaction. That's what mobile allows for us to have that. Because the biggest thing is we want direct connect with our fans, and money kind of gets in the way of that connection of, well, I'm your friend and your fan, but, oh, hey, give me your $10. Give me your $20. If they can go on their phone and buy whatever they want from us in that sense, and it's not, it's frictionless, that kind of helps us maintain more of that connection. Because that's our biggest thing is fan connection and then be able to merchandise our stuff quickly to people the moment they want to get it. If you're at a show, you don't want a person to have to run around forever looking for something. They go on their phone, they can buy it. It's much easier for the merch person. Again, it's just a much easier process. And for us, we need that. Plus, we also need the security once it's done mobily that we have it. You know, that's the biggest thing too, because a lot of times swiping, and you never know. Or if we get paid by a venue, it would be awesome to be able to get paid mobily.
Right.
By a venue, then know the money's there. Then, well, here's a check, or here's this, or
You said a very key word, and that is frictionless.
Yes.
Right. So, Jim, do you think payments are frictionless today? If not, what do we have to do? And you guys are doing so many things right. Why don't we talk a little bit about the problems that we've got, but what's the old adage? You never bitch without a pitch.
Yeah.
How can we fix things if they're wrong?
You know, I think, you know, back to my lead-in, you know, I think, you know, merchants and frankly customers, you know, have some options at their disposal. I think from a merchant standpoint, you know, you can look at mobile payments as a sideline, whether it's in-store payments with your mobile device or truly transacting mobile commerce. You know, it's not easy. You know, I'm not going to stand up here and say that integrating PayPal or integrating Visa Checkout or, you know, brand X Pay is a simple endeavor, but I think the data shows that the customer is going there. And so if we don't meet them there with where they want to engage, whether it's as a fan to buy merchandise at a venue, or if it's standing in a Best Buy showrooming and wanting to buy a television.
Sure.
You know, I think it's how we deliver that experience. And I still get frustrated when, as a consumer, and I'm on my mobile device and I'm doing this. You know, just sure. It's easy stuff like responsive design. You know, just, okay, I think that's the basics. That was 3 years ago. Now it's about how do I deliver customers a very seamless, frictionless option to pay by having my payment credentials, my personal credentials stored in a wallet, right?
Yep.
And I think merchants, they understand that it's out there, but they haven't yet adopted those strategies.
And Richard, maybe I can have you chime in here, because what Jim is saying is absolutely true. The user experience has got to be there, and I would submit that a big portion of that customer experience has got to be wrapped around security, that confidence that no one's going to steal your goods, right?
Yeah. I mean, there's definitely that balance between the two. And in some ways, mobile or confidence of consumers is letting them experience something in the application. So we want payments to be as seamless as possible. We don't want it to frictionless. We don't want it to hold up any of the process. But at the same time, we do want people to know their security, there's something that they participated in. So, there's always a delicate balance between what is the value, what's the amount of money on risk, what is the situation that's involved there. So getting that balance right is going to be a continuing process.
Okay, so you've got a user experience, you've got security. Rick, I mean, what are you hearing from your fans? You know, I think one of the joys of mobile is the promise that you have anytime, anywhere connectivity to anything you want, right?
Right.
There's a convergence happening. So for the first time, Jim, you can actually pay for things too. It's not just access to it. It's the ability to monetize it. What does that mean to somebody like Rick Monroe, who can actually start forming relationships with his fan base and maybe go directly to them?
Well, it frees you up from having to be kind of beholden to any main corporation as far as like a label or anybody else, because now you can self-fund. And there's more and more artists that are self-funding that way, and that means that you can then create the music you believe to be, you know, your art form. Because for a long time, it's basically been there's a very small amount of, you know, radio stations that will play a certain amount of this, and they keep it very tight. But now if all of a sudden you can get people that are on your Facebook and all these other different kind of outlets to start making revenue, you know, from a mobile payment, you'll be able to, again, self-fund and create what you want. And it's going to open up the landscape to a whole lot of different musicians that would otherwise be squeezed out because they don't fit a certain genre.
Sure. And, you know, we spoke earlier about the gold that is the data, right? So can we talk about that for just a moment? Because, Evan, I know you'll have something to say about that, but there's also, best practices. Who's going to store the data? How are we going to use it? You know, so Jim, maybe you could start a little bit with, you know, the opportunities that are out there when you have a transactional data that has, you know, demographic information and a wealth of information that you can use to better serve your customers.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's whether it's your own data or it's leveraging third-party data from a partner. You know, I think that there's the fundamentals of, you know, it was mentioned by Richard earlier about tokenization. So there's a fundamental baseline that as a merchant or as an independent artist who's looking to leverage mobile payments for success, you know, grounding themselves on that the security exists today, right? We have, whether it's PayPal or other organizations out there, have figured out how to securely store payment credentials. So I think it's leveraging your own data, finding a way to monetize that data in a way that's going to make a better experience for your customer or your fan in terms of how they engage with you and your brand.
Terrific. And Richard, is it time for a change in paradigm, or what about the payment process itself?
Well, I think that if I want to extend that in our responsibility with data, is we can look to the Old West. And in the Old West, the gold rush kind of created this opportunity where people had the opportunity to become extremely rich and successful, but at the same time, it also brought criminals. For either the people who didn't become extremely rich or people who are criminals to start with. And so that gold brought all sorts of elements. And you know, same sort of thing with payments. And there's a lot of value going through those payments and the data itself, as you mentioned. And if we think back, originally those criminals, all they had was a bandana and a gun, and they go rob somebody. But the risk reward, you can get this much gold and you could lose your life. So the risk reward was a tough one. So the next thing they do is they evolve to creating gangs. So now they get a couple of them together. So if you're going to shoot, well, the odds of me being shot is 1 in 4 now.
Depending on who you talk to.
And we can go rob from more people at once. And then that evolved to the point where they finally realized, the biggest amount of money is in the banks or is in the safes. So go to the places where the safes are. And so so by having all that money that in one spot, it brought the criminals to that same place. Fast forward back to maybe 5-10 years ago, we started seeing the internet come on board. And with the internet coming on board, we also saw criminals going, wait a second, now we have an opportunity to get to those safes. And those safes in a digital world were the credit card caches, where all the credit card numbers are. So I don't have to rob one, fish one person and get one credit card number. I can go to a TJ Maxx, I can go to a Target, and I can get millions of credit card numbers all in one shot. So so just like the Old West, the criminals are going to follow the money. And the money and the value is not just the transaction. In this case, it also could be the data.
I was looking for a place to insert Butch Cassidy and the Hole in the Wallet gang. So thank you. Try the veal. So Evan, back to you. On the data, there are people talking about how much fraud there are. Is there a danger that the experience from a security perspective could derail the growth that we're starting to see? Remember, if you don't mind, coming at this from two different angles. One is derailing the growth that we're experiencing. And the other thing is we need a kind of a reality check, because when we talk about growth and we're tripling, aren't we like 9 years behind? Or you gave me some stat the other day behind other countries in terms of mobile payments?
Yeah. So definitely security, just if I could touch on that first. In the U.S., as you all know, EMV is the headache right now for everybody. But if you look at a few surveys, a plurality of consumers are using signature and not PIN to authenticate. So, as we know, signature is like a little bit more porous than PIN. So it's not exactly like the predominant system now is perfect, right? So for retailers, things like biometrics and tokenization are solving real problems. And so I think, in a way, the sort of the issues that we've been having with EMV really does open an opportunity for mobile payments in the U.S. to kind of take off a little faster than they were. I'm actually working on something right now about mobile payments in China. And if you look at the volume projections, China is 9 years ahead of us.
Ouch.
So, it's pretty significant, but, there's ways potentially to replicate that success, but unclear so far.
And I think what I'm hearing there is mobile payments is not an if, but a when. The other parts of the world are already showing that it's a very viable way to increase sales and do it in a frictionless way, right? So, I think here in the United States, in fact, on the screen now, you'll see that last year, 17% of purchases were related to mobile devices, right? So for an industry that's just starting and nascent, I think that bodes well for the future. But there's so much more to be done. You know, Rick, for you and your fans, it's that close personal relationship that you have with the fans, right? Have you ever been able to monetize your fan base the way you can with mobile?
No, because even from the scan or the card swipe, that's one of the things we've been able to use getting closer to that. And we have yet to actually finally get, because my dream is to have a situation where there's an app that you go and you go to the show, you can download songs right there, everything's right there, you can, you know, buy your merch right there, and it's just, again, all on the phone. Oh, this is really cool, I want to get this. And we're getting there. It's still, again, you know, we're not quite there, but we're not going to be Napoleon Hill and stop, you know, 3 feet away.
Exactly.
If you don't know who Napoleon Hill is, look that up. It's a very cool story. So I mean, it's still.
Tell them, leave them hanging.
Oh no, they got to do the right. You know, do some homework. It's good. It's good for you guys. Napoleon Hill. It's a great story. But it's not quite implemented. It's close. It's getting there, and we just got to get more and more people to understand. Again, once the safety factor is kind of off the table, and then people realize, wow, this is something that can really happen. You will probably see a ton of different venues and artists and all kinds of different people, you know, implementing this. Because again, if you're a merch person, I don't know if you guys go to a concert. During the concert, the merch person sits there all night. At the end of the show, they're inundated by people. The poor person's got cash, got a credit card swipe. They're going nuts. Well, if you could do all that during the show, just, hey, buy stuff, set it up. People walk by, they scan their thing, done. That's a beautiful world. Everyone's making money. It moves nice and... all your inventory is all on the back end of it. You know what you've sold. That to me is like a perfect world.
Let's extend this a little bit, guys. After all, you are the pay gang. Yeah. So the audience is looking for nuggets of wisdom from you. what's some of the secret sauce? You know, the things that are working for you that the audience could maybe implement into their businesses. Ways that mobile payments can benefit not just the end consumer, but their businesses from an implementation perspective. Rich, you want to start?
Well, I kind of trying to go with that West theme and going back. One of my concerns with the security perspective, which is best practice as far as implementation goes, is we got to close the holes that our legacy technology is leaving behind us. And a good example of that is that. The most proliferant gang in the Old West was a gang called the Newton Gang, and they robbed 87 banks. And the way they robbed 87 banks was they blew up the safe. They blew the front doors off the safe with nitro. And okay, we've all seen that in movies. So what's the special part of that story? Well, the special part of that story is that those 87 banks were on a list of all the banks that had 40-year-old technology or greater. So that they had, because the safe technology at that point was, you couldn't blow it up with nitro. I mean, the materials and everything were so much stronger. But they had a list of the banks where it would work. So they successfully robbed 87 different banks. So in our particular world, we're kind of dependent upon the PAN number, 16 digits. We're dependent upon some of the other methodologies and technologies, and you know we're signing instead of using PIN numbers and things like that. We ought to really look at not leaving those holes open for the future gangs out there.
You know, your analogy was a great one, because you know, you talk about a list and the bad guys going after the low-hanging fruit. That's very much true today, where, you know, as much as a headache as EMV is, you know, it's a lot tougher to hack, and so the bad guys are, you know, turning their attention to card not present, right? And that makes it really difficult for folks in the mobile space, you know, or on, you know, doing online purchases as well. So Jim, you know, you've got not only the US but a global perspective on this. What is it going to take from an end user perspective to just catapult mobile payments to the degree that it becomes our de facto?
Yeah, I'd like to start answering that question with just a quick stat. I mentioned a ComScore study earlier in my lead-in. That same ComScore study said that there's a huge conversion gap in mobile commerce today. 66% of consumers, at least stateside, 66% is time spent on a mobile device.
Wow.
Shopping.
Wow.
But 19% of dollars are through a mobile device. So, i.e., it's like a 47% conversion gap. So what that tells me is that merchants have not yet adopted a way to seamlessly convert their customer, right? And so I think that there's, you know, partnerships, whether it's with Richard's organization or a PayPal or, again, Brand X Wallet, there's companies that out there that have figured out how to beat the bad guys,
yeah.
You know, leveraging tokenization, leveraging different forms of authentication, vaulting payment credentials to keep you as the merchant safe and secure, right? So that you're not, you know, even frankly reducing some of your costs of compliance in terms of, you know, maintaining certain privacy and credentials of a customer on file. So the point of it is there's tools out there that you as a merchant can invest in to give your customer a really, really, really good experience that's memorable. Because in the end, how you're going to close that conversion gap is avoiding that customer not buying from you and going down the road to see another musician because he has a better mobile payments experience.
Right. Terrific. Evan, I'm putting you back on the spot here. You're in the spotlight. So I know that you just finished a report, and there are lots of takeaways for mobile audiences. What are some of the things that we can look for the next 5 years in the mobile payment space?
Yeah. So next 5 years is always sort of on my mind as like the window. But, you know, I think loyalty, I know that's something that we talk about here at the conference a lot, but loyalty is so key because it's really the way that you can unlock a lot of usage in the near future. So there was a survey from, I think, CMB that showed 44% of likely mobile wallet users would test a wallet if there was some type of rewards tied back to it. And if you look at China, again, as sort of the benchmark, really, you look at what's kicked their sort of services off, it's all about bundled features. So you need things like P2P, you need things like messaging, you need things like loyalty, even, you know, if you could hook it up with a financial account, like a money market account. So in terms of replicating that in the US, I would really like to see a lot of mobile wallet brands and retailers collaborating on ways to kind of build that engagement, sort of brick by brick. You know, I'm not sure how predominant bricklaying was in the Wild West at this point, but and if I could just touch on one other wallet, I know like MCX flopping, was the big story this year, and it's begged a lot of questions, I think, among retailers as to, you know, what is the right way to make a wallet, and you know, in this case, I would say MCX definitely was not the bellwether in the mobile wallet space at all. I think. To use a Wild West phrase, I think they struck fool's gold right away. I think they thought they had the right system, but as we saw, it just you can't ignore what the consumer wants, right? But the good thing is there are so many other wallet options that are still out there, still on their way to ramping up. That I think you know, the other cool thing I would say is that there's a lot of non-direct competition between these wallets, right? So it's not that Apple Pay and Samsung Pay are directly competing, because I would argue that a lot of people aren't going to pick a phone purely because of the wallet. We're just thinking here as an ecosystem about how do we build up this entire spectrum of mobile wallet options. And so again, I think with more of a collaborative approach between, you know, different tech providers and different retailers, we can definitely get consumers out there to be adopting, you know, four, even three, whatever it is, wallets.
Right.
And just collectively, we can make that work. And then the last thing I'll say as sort of just like a little nugget, you know, if you look at a lot of the early adopters of wallets, I would argue that many of them are early tech adopters of other things as well. And that's still great for retailers right now. So even if only 10%, 5% of your customers are adopting a mobile wallet, you've probably seen like average order values are higher with these customers. Their frequency of purchasing is higher. These tend to be either higher net worth clients, customers, or just like they're very, very engaged. So even the data we have now, that you have now as retailers, is very valuable, right? And so I think we're already there in the mobile wallet ecosystem of extracting a lot of value. And so I think, again, it's just a question of how wide that net's going to be, how many people are going to adopt it.
Terrific. Guys, I'd like you to kind of take off your hats for a second, your white hats, and think about from each of your disciplines, how could you improve the mobile payment space right now. So, Rick, if you had a way that you could come in and actually improve an experience for consumers or fans trying to buy your merchandise, what's the best way to do that? And each of you, you know, Richard, you might want to pick security. Jim, from a user perspective, a user experience, data, and then, you know, Evan, you have a free reign.
Well, I'll be like a broken record because it still comes through to try to make things frictionless and make it easy. Again, a person hears something, wants it, you want them to be able to get it. But then the good thing is when you start talking about getting their information or the data mining of their, you know, who they are. That's a good way you can make a better experience because then you can find out who they are and you can also tailor things to them and say, hey, we have a special thing. We're doing this. If you buy a certain amount of things, we'll give you these things. And that's something that would be so helpful to us to get to not just to know people from the point of social media, but to actually start to get to know them by their purchasing and what they're into. So that would be good. I kind of wanted to lead at a question for you, sort of.
Okay.
We were talking about security. Now, a lot of things, you're talking about the gangs that come in from outside. What about the insider, the guy who's like telling on, you know, hey, the Wells Fargo thing is going down this road and it's full of gold. Like, where do you guys fit on that?
And actually, there's a nice story for that. Uh-huh. So there was a train robbery about 40 miles from here, and the train robbery netted $3 million for the crooks. And the way that train robbery took place is the federal government figured out the best way to thwart the criminals was we're going to obscure where the money is. Instead of putting it in the safe, we're going to put it in with the mail. So they had bags and bags and bags of cash, $3 million worth of cash, in with the different mail trucks trains.
Boxcars.
And so what happened was is that a postal inspector tipped off a gang. I know where money is. You guys hold it up and we'll share it. And so that's the same thing we're dealing with today, which is, you know, we really have to watch out for social engineering. No matter what our technology is, there has to be layers of security because there will always be a postal inspector. There will always be someone that somehow it can get through that trusted network. So you need to have, you know, ways of watching data, watching what's taking place, of adding different workflows and security aspects in place. So you got to layer it all together. By the way, remember I mentioned that the gang the Newton gang who robbed 87 banks? They're the same gang that robbed that train too. So pretty
busy.
Successful.
They figured it out.
To you, Jim.
You know, I think from an experience standpoint, I'd love to live in a world where I want to buy something online or in a store. I can pull up my mobile phone and do this.
Yeah.
It's already there. I mean, that our ecosystem isn't even close to being there. Obviously, you know, I talked about the conversion gap. And I think if merchants can provide that type of an experience, again, through a variety of partnerships, Evan mentioned a number of wallet providers that are out there. I think the technologies exist. It's about making a selection. And it's not just one selection. I think there's so many good options that where your customers have brand affinity, whether it's to an issuer, whether it's to a network, whether it's to, you know, a company like PayPal, it doesn't really matter. I think it's about giving your customer that choice and those set of options that if they want to have a wallet, they want to transact securely in your store or from the comfort of their own couch and do that in a very secure way without entering their payment credentials, my shipping address, billing address, and having that stored on file in a secure wallet. To me, I think that's a win. Not only from a consumer, that's a great experience, but from a merchant standpoint. And I think as we do that, merchants will win because they'll start to realize the benefit of some of that gold that's hanging out there because there's a lot of it out there.
Yeah, and I think that's a great takeaway, Jim, not only from a security perspective, but for everybody in the audience, how do you come up with a winning mobile initiative? You know, you take everything that the pay gang has set up here on stage and you wrap it in one big blanket, which is providing your customers, whether they're consumers or whether they're another business, and make those transactions frictionless. You should be using mobile payments and this mobile device to do what it was created to do, communicate. And if you can better connect with your audiences, you'll retain them, right, Jim? And you can better utilize them. They're already predisposed in many cases to use your products and services. So if you have their data, using that data in a best practices scenario can really be that gold mine, can it?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and if I had like a magic wand and I can just change everything.
You're going to get one, by the way. They all know, you guys, inside joke. At the end of our session here, each of the panelists gets a magic wand. Whatever they want to change the mobile space. And so that was the joke.
Yeah.
Go ahead, sorry.
Can I answer that now?
Yeah. You only get one.
Yeah, this is true.
Analysts. No,
I've been thinking about that question a lot though, and you know, I think for what would be ideal in my world, and I think it is feasible. But you know, I was talking with somebody about this, and until I can replace, you know, my entire wallet, right, and put it on my phone, you know, I think that is like going to really kickstart adoption for the average consumer. Because I talk to a lot of people about this, you know, what's preventing you from trying Apple Pay or any of these wallets, and they're saying, well, all that it's really replacing is that card swipe. That's all it's replacing for me right now. But if I can put my Metro card on my wallet, if I can put my ID on my wallet, if I can put, so basically until I can throw my physical wallet into the trash can, right, I don't necessarily, I think it's going to be, there's going to be some hurdles for adoption among like the average consumer. And so I think if we could just get that sort of capability across the spectrum for all the wallet providers, like right now, I would love to see consumers just rushing to adopt those wallets.
And they may, Evan, you know, if you do what you just mentioned, but also you wrap that in incentives, right?
Yep.
What an awesome opportunity to incent your users to use you. And Jim, if you don't mind, could you talk for a second about ways that you can not only attract, but retain and better monetize your users through incentives, loyalty programs, sure, all these things?
Yeah, you know, I think that it's a farce to say that not every wallet provider out there wants to share data. I think a lot of them do. There's a few that don't. There's a few that want to keep that data and monetize it themselves. The reality is that a lot of the wallet... They're a good company.
They are a good company.
I'm a very loyal device.
I know.
So you know, I think that the point of it is that there are options out there where you can, as a merchant, engender loyalty with your customer base and do that through the auspices of a wallet. Whether that customer is just a pure play mobile e-commerce shopper or they're a physical in-store shopper, the reality is that I think the word convergence, that's a good one. I like to use it. Was mentioned earlier where you know stores are closing. We're not becoming any less busy, I think, as Americans, and so our time is pretty precious. So I think if you know those lines are being blurred of those pure play physical store shoppers becoming desktop shoppers, becoming mobile shoppers, and so I think giving that customer that seamless experience across all channels is important, and giving them access to your loyalty program without having to jump through a couple more hoops. Okay. So the point is you know, be willing as a merchant to commit to a partnership where you can actually bring your data to bear, and also you should get something in return in that partnership and have that wallet provider share data with you.
That makes a lot of sense. And for those people who attended the last session in here, there was a gentleman from FIS, I believe, that made a statement that resonated rather well with me. He said something to the effect of, if you give someone a donut, they'll give you their social security number or their children. And I think what that says is if you do incent people, they'll go after you. They'll become loyal, you know. And if you treat them correctly, I think you'll see that folks stick around a lot longer. You'll see much more of a brand loyalty. And I think that's maybe what's missing in a lot of brick and mortar environments that are going, you know, out of business now.
Yeah, I think I'll just add on to that point. We rolled out at PayPal a technology called One Touch, not to plug PayPal, but there's an interesting data point that came from it. Basically, it allows you, like Amazon figured this out early, we've adopted it and adapted it, but basically your payment credentials are stored on your device within a browser via cookie for 6 months. And so long as you use PayPal, any merchant that accepts PayPal, you don't have to log in again. So we've eliminated that step in terms of increasing conversion for a merchant in the mobile plane. What's really phenomenal about that as a follow-up is what we found is for every 5% increase in engagement with that customer with that retailer on a mobile device has led to 1.5 times more transactions.
Wow.
I mean, that's a real honest stat. Yeah, get rid of the fridge. That is just, you can't dispute that.
Okay. Right. So guys, I want to talk a little bit more about data and who's riding shotgun to protect that data. Okay. So, you know, I think in many ways we as consumers are really worried not only about theft or fraud, but you know, you don't want these devices to be anything more than a pristine environment where you only get the things that you want, right? So, you know, Rick, from your perspective, and Richard, from yours, what does best practices in use of data mean? You know, some takeaways that the folks in the audience can use.
I think the first thing was, you don't need to inundate people with stuff. It's just like social media. You don't need to post every 5 seconds what you're doing and go, buy my single, do this, do that. I mean, you have to create more of a relationship with people, now more so than ever. So I think best practice would be being responsible with their information and only using it when it's something that you feel will be to their benefit, not just to your benefit. You can't always look to what's good for me. It's you, because you want these people to be around.
Right.
It's about brand strength and brand loyalty. So I think that's, to me, that would be a good practice.
You know, the mobile devices and the data that it collects creates such a great opportunity for an experience for a consumer. But at the same time, we don't want to go down the path where we have, like, do not call list on phones.
Sure.
Because we have phones and people start calling and hassling us or email junk. So I think we need to be very, very careful with the data. We ought to let people, the owners of the data are the people whose the data is on, right? We ought to let them let us know how we should use it on their benefit and let them have control of that in case they change their mind. And I think if we do that, we have a nice balance in the ecosystem.
Very nice. Okay, so it is time, guys, for you to get out your magic wands, all right? The mobile payments landscape is, as we said, very much like the Old West. Still lots of trains being robbed. But on the other side, there's some really cool things happening in the general store, aren't there? So, Rick, I'm going to start with you. You know, change anything you want with that mobile wand. What is it going to be?
Is it okay if I steal Evan's? Because that's pretty much the...
he wants two.
Yeah, no, but no, I meant his idea. Because honestly, being able to throw away your wallet would be... What a great thing that would be. Because not have to worry about... Plus, you would be able to... The worst thing is, we're on the road. You're going to buy gas. You have to use a card for it. Then which card do I use because I want to get the points or the this? Or you're having to figure that out and find the best price. Then you have to get the receipt. Then you have to input it somewhere. Like, can you imagine eliminating all those steps? How much nicer that would be?
That's the promise of wireless.
I mean, that would be so much. I'd be like, great, I do it, boom, forget about it, move on. At the end of the month, I look at my statement, nice.
Yep.
That would be a wonderful thing.
Terrific. And I would be remiss if I didn't take a second here to, while we're talking about the use of data, we actually co-authored a living document called Mobile Payments Bill of Rights. I have some copies up here if anybody wants them. The idea that we had was not for any company to take ownership of it. You're not going to see AP Technology on the document. What we wanted to do is take some learnings that we've had, you know, from AP Technology over the almost 30 years and, you know, some of the experiences I've had globally in mobile payments. And we also listen to analysts. We also listen to end users. We dummied it down, if you don't mind me using that term, into just a few elements that are called Mobile Payments Bill of Rights. I delivered that to Congress on Capitol Hill. That was last year. And my communication to them was pretty simple. It was, please leave us alone, right? The fastest way to stagnate growth is to regulate it. So, you know, that's my magic wand would be if we all could embrace best practices, whatever they are. I said this was a living document. It's very true. I hope people add to that. We want people to modify it so that we have that customer experience, Jim, that you described so well during this, and you too, Rick, so that people are using their devices and transacting with confidence. Richard.
Okay, my magic wand?
Yes, sir.
All right, so what I'd like to do is I imagine that using this mobile device, first, I'm going to a concert, so it's the artist of the year, Rick Monroe.
Rick Monroe, of course, yeah.
And he sent me a special discount on the tickets since he won't give me a free ticket.
Next time, I promise.
But not only am I able to get that discount and buy the tickets cheaper, but I'm also able to buy the merchandise on the application and then have a drone delivered to my seat so I don't have to get up and pick it up. That's all I'm asking.
Well played. Well played.
Nice.
Wield that magic wand.
Yeah, you know, I mentioned my magic wand wish earlier when I talked about it. I'd like to just be able to, like, do this.
Yeah, that's
a
great one.
And if you think about, you know, the analogy back to the Old West, right? And there's, you know, two gunslingers, you know, the OK Corral. And, you know, I want my customer to be able to do that. And it's like, okay, I win because I just did that. But so I'm going to take Evan's thunder and say I want a second magic wand. And I'd like, because I still have a lot of merchant customers and prospects that still have stores, right?
Sure.
I think that's our last mile is PayPal as the world converges, is how do we win at the brick and mortar level. And I'd love to eliminate the word showrooming. I think that's just a bad word. I think that if a customer comes in your store to buy something, they should leave that store with a very delightful experience and having bought something from you. Well, merchants can do that today. If they have a really good mobile experience, I can open up my phone and say that item isn't in inventory, but if I do want a price check, there's data out there where you can geofence me and say, oh, pop you an offer, guess what? I can match that price and deliver it to your house before you get home.
Great experience. Terrific. We are going to be opening this up for questions and answers in just a second, but not before we go to Evan, who, how many magic wands are you up to now? Five or something?
I can keep my second one really short, but I just want payments to be as invisible as possible. As a consumer, that's what I want. So, you know, ideally, I would have my own like AI avatar making payments for me. Like that would be just another Evan out there in the universe, buying, you know, reorders of shampoo, buying reorders of this. And Amazon Payments, the Dash replenishment, I think is getting there actually, but ideally everywhere. But that's my really really quick second.
Watch what you ask for. There's some people out there willing to do that for you.
That's true.
Okay, you know what? We're running a little short on time, so with apologies, I'm going to ask anybody with a question, come on up, and we'll be happy to answer them. But for now, I would really like to thank the Pay Gang, Rick Monroe, Richard Love. We have Jim Shortan, and also Evan Baker, the Pay Gang, guys.